What's up, everybody? My name is Max Feinstein, and I'm an anesthesia resident at the Mount Sinai Hospital in New York City. In this video, I'm interviewing the chief of neuroanesthesia at Mount Sinai Hospital, Dr. Ben Toure. I just finished my month-long neuroanesthesia rotation and had the privilege of spending many days in the operating room with Dr. Toure. It was a very interesting month, and I thought it would be a great opportunity to make a video about neuroanesthesia, so Dr. Toure very graciously agreed to let me interview him. If you find this video interesting or helpful, I'd really appreciate it if you liked it and subscribed to the channel. Let's dive in.
My name is Ben Toure. I am originally from Guinea, West Africa, and I went to college in Philadelphia, and then I came to medical school in New York. I've been in New York ever since medical school. I trained here at Mount Sinai and at SUNY Downstate in Brooklyn, and I've had a strong interest in neuroanesthesia from Downstate. That's basically what I've been doing since after residency training, is neuroanesthesia.
And that's how I got to know you.
Right.
As a first-year anesthesia resident, as a CA1,
right.
I was rotating through neuroanesthesia, and we spent a lot of time together in the OR.
Right.
And it was a very interesting rotation. Yeah. I learned a lot.
I'm glad you did.
You were willing to sit for this interview, so that rotation at least went well enough that you were willing to spend a little bit more time with me.
I hope so. I mean, I think it was a good rotation. I kind of a little biased because I work here with mainly here in neuro, but I think it's a good rotation for the residents to see and the medical students too.
What's the position that you hold here on faculty at Mount Sinai specifically?
So on faculty here specifically, I'm in charge of neuroanesthesia, I'm the neuroanesthesia chief.
You know, a lot of medical students aren't very familiar with anesthesia as a field. And I would say even fewer are familiar with neuroanesthesia. I, for one, had no idea that that was even a subspecialty until I came and did an away rotation. So then I got introduced to neuroanesthesia. Can you help me understand, what is it that makes neuroanesthesia its own subspecialty?
So it's its own specialty because the nuances within anesthesia that have to be specific to just neuro. For example, if we're doing a patient that's having a spinal cord detethering procedure, that patient will require someone that has familiarity with somatosensory motor evoked potential monitoring and motor evoked potential monitoring on top of the regular general anesthetic techniques that are applied to other surgical procedures.
Or what would you say are some of the unique anesthetic considerations of neurosurgery, in addition to being familiar, as you said, with some of the evoked potential monitoring?
It depends on the kind of operation we're doing. If we're doing operations in the brain, sort of the unique sort of considerations are ways to manage intracranial hypertension and manage cerebral perfusion pressures. Those are quite specific to just neuroanesthesia. You know, for example, patients that are having aneurysm surgery because they had a subarachnoid hemorrhage from an aneurysm rupture, the considerations there are quite different from, for example, a patient that's having a laparotomy done for a hemicolectomy. We kind of have to manage their blood pressures to their circle of Willis as opposed to just managing their blood pressure to their aortic arch pressures that we do for a general non-neural kind of operations.
In practical terms, what sort of changes does that necessitate for your anesthetic plan if you're going to do, say, a craniotomy instead of laparoscopic surgery?
Multiple things. From a pharmacologic standpoint, we've pushed towards doing mainly total intravenous anesthesia for these operations because we find that doing total intravenous anesthesia helps and minimizes interference with the neural monitoring, the monitoring of the, you know, corticospinal tracts and the spinal thalamic tracts, and sometimes even brainstem auditory evoked potentials. If we do just TEVA, total intravenous anesthesia, we tend to have less interference and maybe even better monitoring. So that's sort of the pharmacologic consideration. Now, as far as how to protect the brain, there's neuroprotective things that we can do with you know, hyperventilating the patient so that we'll have cerebral vasoconstriction that will lower the patient's intracranial pressure. When we do neuromonitoring, we can actually use EEG monitoring to, you know, let you know how deep the patients are and titrate the anesthetic to the level of depth that we want him to be during the resection. You know, there's some of the more rare operations, not rare, but not as common, which are the awake craniotomy operations, and that's kind of its own special sort of subspecialty within neuro as well, where we're putting the patients under general anesthesia, but for a very short time, and then the patients are awake throughout the procedure so that we can do the resection without causing any sort of injury to them. And then towards the end of the operation, the patients will either stay awake or, depending upon how much work needs to be done, they'll go back under general anesthesia.
You've mentioned neuromonitoring several times, and I've met some of our neuromonitoring specialists as I was rotating with you.
Yeah.
Help me understand why we do neuromonitoring and what is it?
So neuromonitoring is essentially another layer of safety or security to maintain the patient's neural pathways or to minimize damage if damage does happen. I'll give you an example. If a patient has a big spinal cord procedure, you know, spinal cord operation being done, say for example for, I don't know, the patient is having a laminectomy and decompression for nerve injuries from decompression, for example, or even trauma, it would be good to be able to maintain the patient's neurologic status the way it was and then improve it without injuring them while you're trying to do this operation. So having neuromonitoring is a safety mechanism for that, to prevent such injury from happening. Safe to say it's specific to neurosurgery and orthopedic surgery, a little bit of vascular surgery that directly involve the brain. In other words, carotid endarterectomy sometimes are done with neuromonitoring, but which makes sense because that's perfusion to the brain.
What does one have to do to become a neuromonitor?
The people who do neuromonitoring have to go to a specific school, a training program for it. I think it's about a 2-year program. And then once they do that, they obviously, within that training, they have to do clinical rotations as well. And then there's usually an neurologist or a neurosurgeon that oversees the technicians who are doing the monitoring and interpreting what the EEG findings are. In this hospital, that role is spread out between, I think, 2 neurosurgeons and 1 neurologist who do the overall interpretation of the monitoring. But we have at least a dozen technicians there who are actually in the room and measuring it. We can do it too in anesthesia, and it's in fact tested quite a bit in anesthesia. But because our focus is on so much of the patient itself, other things to do, we've sort of delegated that duty to a subspecialty of neuromonitoring people.
What other type of equipment do you normally have in a neurosurgery operating room that you use that wouldn't necessarily be found in other types of operating rooms?
Other than the neuromonitoring specific portion, like we said, SSEPs and EMGs and motor evoked, other than that, sometimes we're faced with actually directly measuring the patient's intracranial pressure. So we'll transduce a catheter to the patient's ventricle and we'll be monitoring their ICP. The other issue that we can sometimes monitor is actually sometimes the patients have external ventricular drains, and we'll be monitoring how much fluid is coming out of that drain and communicating that with the surgeons. And there are times where we have to release more CSF fluid or less. That's another role that we're trusted with doing, besides the normal regular vital signs and sometimes even the beats monitor, if you want to go that route as well.
What's it like working with neurosurgeons?
In general, my perception is that they're very nice. They're usually very, very smart and also very humble and listen to everyone's opinion before making up their mind. So if I was to give a general, in my opinion, they're a very nice bunch of people to work with.
I take my Bluetooth speaker into the operating room. set it up and put on some music. So I haven't really gotten too much of a sense of what type of music my colleagues on the other side of the drapes listen to. But perhaps you have. I'm curious to know, what kind of music do neurosurgeons listen to while they're working, if any?
It's a funny thing. One of the neurosurgeons here doesn't want any music in the room at all. I sort of understand why he doesn't want any music, because he's doing the pretty complex vascular operations and he doesn't want any sort of a distraction. So no loud talking, no music. Even our monitors, we turn the volumes down a little bit. But there are other surgeons who do pretty invasive operations too. They listen to everything. They listen to reggae. They had a guy here who liked to listen to classical music. And then there are others that, you know, whatever you feel like playing. They leave it up to the other staff in the room to decide, and they're just happy to go with it. It all depends on the personality.
What do you like to play?
I like to play a lot of reggae, but lately I've been playing a lot of international world music, music from the Sahara in Africa.
Next time we're in an OR together, we'll put on your Spotify playlist.
Okay.
Of your choosing.
Yeah. It'll be fun. I think you'll enjoy my list as well.
I assume you also work in the general ORs doing anesthesia for types of surgery beyond neurosurgery. Can you talk about the balance that you have between doing anesthesia for neurosurgery and then other types of cases?
I'm here doing neuroanesthesia maybe 4 days a week, and then the other day I'm sometimes here or sometimes in the main OR. Because I take call, I have to cover, you know, all comers, from endoscopy to, you know, general surgery, sometimes even delivery sections. You know, whatever comes, we have to be able to sort of handle it comfortably as well. So I do other operations as well, but I'm primarily here for, I'll say, at least 80% of the time.
Can you tell me about your work-life balance and how much call you take, the length of your typical work day?
Because we're doing neuroanesthesia, our operations can be pretty long operations. We do take call, overnight call. So when we're on overnight call, we come in later in the day and work till the next day. If you don't want to stay long in neuroanesthesia, you can choose to do the most specific 1 to 2 level spine operations. And that would be interesting as well, but they're shorter operations. I'll say a short day would be a day that you walk 7 hours a day.
And then you had mentioned longer surgeries. How long can these neurosurgeries go for?
It depends. You know, they have operations. Some neurosurgeries, procedures can go for 8, 9, 10, 12 hours.
What kind of surgery would that be that takes so long?
For example, a severe GBM that's in a really difficult location. Those patients can have, you know, 2 subspecialties doing the operation. You can have an ENT surgeon, usually a rhinologist that comes, and they can easily work for 5 or 6 hours to get the exposure, and then a neurosurgeon will come in and do their part of the operation. That could easily add another 3-4 hours there.
You had mentioned that you frequently use TEVA, that we frequently use TEVA.
Yeah.
What agents do you most commonly incorporate as part of total IV anesthesia?
Over the past maybe 6-7 years, I've come to rely heavily on remifentanil, but we do a lot of propofol and remifentanil. I know people that do propofol and maybe some dexmetamidine as well. And I know people that do propofol and fentanyl. But because remifentanil essentially doesn't have a contact-sensitive half-life, it's plasmesterase metabolized, I rely heavily on it because then I can turn it off quickly and get a neurologic exam on the patient. If the patient needs to go downstairs for a CAT scan because there's a concern of a bleed post-op, I'm fairly confident that the remifentanil will be gone quickly and the propofol I titrate. So I'm fairly confident that the delayed awakening is not because of an anesthetic issue per se.
What would you say are some of the biggest challenges of doing neuroanesthesia?
The biggest challenges are, you know, the patient's conditions. These are very difficult operations to do. Sometimes the risk of a stroke as a complication is a significant one. The risk of a neurologic deficit is a significant one after neuroanesthesia. Usually something that we talk about to the patient about it and plan for it, but they're not without risk, you know. So I would say that's the most difficult part of being a neuroanesthesia, but you know, we do help a lot of people, and if these operations are not done, then people don't have a chance to cure their illnesses and their tumors or their malformations that they have, or even their seizures that they have. So that's the hardest part to me.
Curious if you would like to speak at all to being a minority physician and what that has been like in terms of your training, your practice, anything that you'd like to share about that.
You know, it's an interesting thing. I finished training in 2007. 2020 now. You know, in those 13 years of working, I actually haven't seen an increase in the number of underrepresented minority residents or attendings for that matter. But I'm told that they are, I just haven't personally seen it. So that's kind of surprising and maybe even shocking a little bit. Here at Mount Sinai, I feel that we don't have enough minority students, but I'm hopeful that that will change within my lifetime. As far as my own personal self being a minority in anesthesia or in neuroanesthesia, I actually haven't seen any basis for any sort of a concern or anything. I feel like I get treated the way I get treated outside of the hospital. Some people are nice, others are not. Some people are polite, others are not. I just kind of do what I have to do, and I try to be good at what I do, and let the rest take care of itself.
Is there anything that I haven't asked you about that you think would be interesting for a medical student or the general public who's watching this?
Well, I think for medical students, considering different subspecialties in anesthesia or in medicine in general, I highly recommend anesthesia and neuroanesthesia, as biased as that sounds. I think intellectually it's very, very interesting, and technically as well, as far as the actual procedures that we would physically do with our hands, I think they're quite challenging but very interesting. So I would encourage any student that wants to come and do a rotation with us or read about anesthesia and neuroanesthesia to go ahead and do it. It's very rewarding in that way. I've had, you know, kids and their parents basically crying in happiness at the end of the operation that we were able to wake up their kid and extubate them right away. It's very fulfilling and rewarding in that sense.
It's quite a sales pitch for neuroanesthesia as I think about what subspecialty, if any, I'd like to do.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for your time.
Most welcome, Feinstein. Thank you very much. It was fun.
I really appreciate it.
Thank you.
Likewise.